Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this, the third in the Mr. Urban Futures series of annual lectures, where we bring people with international reputations in fields related to our transdisciplinary work on urban sustainability and futures to engage with us and with you as part of our efforts and initiatives to speak both to the academic audiences in our two universities, but equally importantly to our non-academic partner institutions and citizens of Göteborg and vicinity at large. That is very much a central part of our mission as a research into policy and practice center. We started this series in 2016, and this is, as I say, our third annual lecture. We will have about an hour, after which we invite you to share some refreshments in the foyer behind us. And with that, I will hand over to my colleague, artistic professor Henrietta Palmer, who is our deputy scientific director, to introduce our guest this evening, the renowned architect Jan Gehl. Henrietta.
Thank you very much, David. Good evening, everybody. I'm delighted to introduce to you Professor Jan Gehl. And I would like to start this introduction by giving some short histories. My very first interaction with the work of Jan Gehl happened as a student in of architecture in the mid-80s, when somebody pointed out a set of benches in a central square in Stockholm, telling me that these benches were placed there according to the philosophy of Jan Gehl. And I understood later that what this was implied was that these benches were placed where you, as a human being, would find it most pleasurable to sit down in relation to what you could see and what you could sense. And as such, that these benches were an oppositional move in relation to the rationality of the late modernistic planning that they were surrounded by. With his seminal book, The Life Between Buildings, from 1971, Jan Gehl has introduced an approach to city planning based on how people interact with the physical environment for most comfort, pleasure, and social exchange. These benches were a radical attempt for someone at the City Planning Office of Stockholm to recapture and recreate a basic human condition of the urban environment that had been lost in this place specifically, but more so in urban planning generally. 30 years later, I met with a young Portuguese architect working in one of the favelas of Rio de Janeiro. Issues around physical violence in the public realm were on her table daily, but also issues of how to build public life, engaging in the situations of children, of women, and elderly people through creating safe spaces for their daily existence. I asked her where she was planning to go next as her contract was running out. And she responded that she wanted to go to Copenhagen and work for Jan Gehl. This desire from a young international activist architect in a favela of Rio de Janeiro highlighted for me how Jan Gehl's philosophy and approach had remained at the center of an urban debate, moving from the rethinking of modernist planning to provide relevance for context of an extreme urban urgency. These two small glimpses connect what is central for the philosophy of Jan Gehl, which is not only about how we as humans can live and coexist in the city, but more so how our physical bodies interact with physical form, and how physical form can enable our bodies to contribute to the evolvement of urban life. For more than 50 years, Professor Gehl, together with his colleagues, have been researching the gap between social science and architecture, the interaction of human life and form, developing from this research applicable theories on spatial analysis. Starting off in the 70s with teaching at the Architecture Academy in Copenhagen, Professor Gehl used the city of Copenhagen as a laboratory for his work with students, eventually resulting in the studios impacting the planners and the politicians of the city. And from these experiences, he made the first application of his theories as a practitioner in Oslo in 1987. In 2000, he starts Gehl Architects together with Helle Søholt, with ambition to transform evolved theory into practice for cities around the world. And since then, their practice had grown not only into teams of collaborators with two offices also in San Francisco and New York, but also into an international network working with city planning authorities and public and private organizations across the world. Well-known examples are their work in London, the radical work with Broadway and Times Square in New York, development of spaces for walking and biking in Moscow, to be followed by work in Amman, Sydney, Brighton, San Francisco, Sao Paulo, etc., collectively forming a portfolio of projects in 250 cities worldwide. Professor Gehl has also consequently continued to develop theories from practice-based research. In 2010, he published Cities for People, and in 2013, How to Study Public Life, together with Birgitte Svare. 2 years ago, Gehl Institute was inaugurated in New York, developing ethnographic and spatial tools, learning situation and research, not only to improve physical spaces, but also to strengthen civic capacity and to make people equipped to contribute to and to improve public life. To list all the contributions in terms of projects, books, exhibitions, and teaching across the world, inventions in terms of tools, analysis, and assessment strategies, and rewards that Professor Gehl and his team have achieved over the years would take up a large part of this remaining lecturing time. I will therefore rather finish by referring to the ethos of the climate activist Greta Thunberg, who has recently reached a great impact worldwide by simply stating that we know already what we need to do to save the climate. Translating this statement to the city, we could suggest that we already know what we need to do to achieve a sustainable city. And what Professor Gehl is continuously reminding us of is that the intermingling of human life and the built environment is not only a measurement of sustainable cities, but is the very way through which we can make them. Most welcome, Professor Gehl.
Tack ska du ha. Good evening. I'll speak svensk, no, English. Though you could, and I hope you can understand my English. It's rather slow, Scandinavian accent English, and I have only a vocabulary of 300 words. I think you will be all right. It's very nice to see Gothenburg once again, and Chalmers, where I've been many, many times in my time. But let's get started, and we start here, maybe. Or here. No. Maybe here. That was better. Okay, I saw that this organization was called something about future. So I thought I better start with something about future. I've been thinking much about this and you meet it all over the place. But there's quite a bit of confusion. Let us see. Mm-hmm. Here we are. Okay. I was in India last year, and I was going to this conference, Building for the Future and Restoring the Past. This was their poster. And I walked all over the place and showed all the Indians this poster, say, could you please tell me, is this the future or the past? And they said, oh, no, that's the future. And I said, holy Moses, which has no relevance in India. But I was shocked because this shows Atlanta, Georgia in 1972. And that was the future of India. Oh, my dear. Then I went to another conference with UN Habitat just after they made the 17 principles. And this was their poster. And I thought, gee, this is a poster from India all over again, but now with 4 or 6 windmills and 2 hospitals and a special lane for the bus. And I said, gee, we have a long way to go to find out about future of cities. Then I was on another conference in Germany about good cities for the elderly, and I was shown this poster of Wohnstadt für Demenz, and I hope I'll never get in that situation and be forced to live in this awful environment. But then, of course, when you get around, you see this fantastic hype about when only we get the automatic cars. Oh, that's interesting. When only we get the automatic cars, all the problems we ever had will be solved. And here is the rendering by Ford. And to make sure, they say it's many, many decades from now, it could look like this. Oh, this illustration makes me happy that I'm rather old. I will never see this, because what a genuinely awful technocratic environment. And when you get to the city in the background, it will be somewhat worse. I do think that the automatic car is a very interesting proposition, and I do think that it will especially be interesting for the car industry. And it will be a fantastic challenge to harness this gimmick so that we can use it sensitively and sensitively and not senselessly. In Sao Paulo, I heard someone say, when we have the automatic cars, we don't need to have more freeways because we can have double so many units on the freeways we have. Holy Moses. Also, you meet people who say that whatever is not solved by automatic cars will be solved by drones and helicopters. And again, I say, holy Moses. Think about the sky being full of these animals. And look at the city they're going to serve. Would you like to have raised children there? I question. Then you hear much about smart cities. And everybody get very excited. Smart is quite fantastic. It's not so smart that this guy in the middle of the street has found out where this bicycle lane is. But again, there is something which goes through all this. It's something about that man is a very, very smart animal. He can invent fantastic things, and we get very exciting to hear about all the things we can invent. And all these companies, they are absolutely hysterically happy about the prospect of finding a gimmick which they can sell in 5-6 billion copies all over the world. So it's all about some mechanical thing, some gimmicks which shall be sold and which shall be spread out of the world and will save the day for us. But it will all be very costly, and we have to harness it very, very carefully if we shall make sure that it makes better cities for us. One of my colleagues made a search on Google about future cities, and this was what she came up with. There's not a single of these places you would like to spend 1 minute in. And think about raising children and being old in these places. It's just architects doodling on paper and showing how fantastic they can make the shapes if they are not bound by any practical purposes. We have a lot of discussion about future cities, and it's very intermingled with all this technology which we shall buy and implement. And I think that some of it is interesting if we can handle it properly. But we will have to know that the major problems of this world is not going to be solved by expensive technology, because the major problem lies in the fast-growing cities in the third world, and it's in Africa and in Southeast Asia. 90% of all the urbanization in the future will happen. Already now, 1/4 live in slums, and they are not the ones who will buy all these automatic cars. So these are the real problems of the future of the cities. All the other things are playthings and gimmicks for some parts of the world, of the rich world. So I'm a little bit skeptic about all this hysteria about new technology which will save the day for all of us. And I've started to speculate about what if the future has already arrived? What if we have some models already which can give us better cities in the future more sustainable cities and more cities generally. And I have the idea that maybe the future has started and we have models which we can copy and right away without cost implement also in the poor cities. So that's where I start. Livable cities for the 21st century, and I'll talk about the importance of putting people first in your planning, in your thinking. We have, in the past 60 years, had some very dominating urban planning paradigms which have totally dominated everything. And they are still hanging around, and they have really screwed up the world we are living in, the cities we are living in. One, of course, is modernism, and I'll not go into long stories about modernism. It started out in the 20s, and they made interesting stuff in the 30s. It was very socially motivated. But then came the late modernism and sort of the explosion of modernism, and that was from 1960 and onwards, when all the cities started to grow after the war, and then modernism was there ready to be used and to be mass-produced in factories and concrete elements. But there was a lot of thinking in this modernism, all this about that you have work here and you have living there and you have recreation there and you have communication there, and don't ever put them together. And Corbusier, whom with this sketch illustrated, cities are bad, don't do cities no more, and don't do streets, don't do squares. All bad things come from streets and squares, street girls and street boys and parliament of the street and barricades across the street and whatever. Make freestanding building with lots of grass. That is good. And then he called this the vertical garden city, where from every residence you could see some grass in the beginning. Later you could see the parking lot. And then it all was to look like Tæby here. It's interesting. Yeah, also one of the things the modernists did really was to define that we don't have Homo sapiens evermore. Now we have a new species, modern man. And this modern man was very rational. He was running full speed from his bed to his work and back again. And they made much fun of the old days where they were sort of doodling along and walking slowly and having a good time. Now it has to be very rational. I have this illustration of the modern man from a Swedish book from 1931. I think it was called Acceptera. And I think, was it Asplund? No? Anyway, Swedish it was, Acceptera. This was the illustration of the modern man. Then I went to Lübeck this year in January, and somebody said, hey, why do you have Joseph Goebbels in your lecture? Oh, my dear, the Swedes knew Joseph Goebbels already in 1931. Oh, my word. Anyway, they defined we have modern man. We have to make everything different. We cannot use anything of the past because the situation is completely changed now. We need modern flats. We need modern buildings. We need modern architecture, modern site plans, modern city planning. Everything has to be for this new creature. And that was the biggest manipulation with the settlements of Homo sapiens ever done. Before this was introduced, this modernistic philosophy, we always built the cities around spaces. If you think of all the nice old cities, you know, you can hardly point to a single building. You can point to a number of nice spaces. This is a space from Venice, and everything happened in spaces. People walked there, they traded there, they met each other there. Everything happened in spaces which were dimensioned and were comfortable for people. That was very important for the life of the cities. Now suddenly the focus was moved from the spaces to the objects. And then instead of spaces in the modernistic architecture, you have leftover space, which is completely different from having spaces which are comfortable for people. Actually, there's nothing more uncomfortable for people than leftover space. This, of course, is Corbusier's plan for Paris, to save Paris, take it down and build 21 high-rise building, 24, where all the Parisians can sit up there and see how beautiful their city is. And there's a lot of leftover space for the automobiles to have a good time. This focus on the objects is again the background, because if we can't make better spaces, what can we then do now? We can make funny buildings. And many people are now engaged in making funny buildings. They don't make anything better. It just follows the fashion, and they compete in making funny stuff all over the place. What happened really in great scale from 1960 and onwards, the city was growing, large units were needed, and the city planners went up in the aeroplane. They were about 5 kilometers up, and then they started to organize their buildings, their cities from 5,000 meters, and they moved the objects around. They were always hanging over the model. Forget that. They were hanging over the model and moving them around. Bingo, this is a good city. The site planners, where they were hanging over all of this in helicopters and making minor adjustments. Down here, where the people were supposed to move around to be, nobody was asked to look after that. The planners thought the architects would do it, and the architects thought that the landscape architects would do it. They were down on their knees anyway, so they could look after that. But if you look at the education of architects and the education of landscape architects, even to this day, there is very small elements of knowledge of people and city at eye level in the education. What happened was that with modernism, that was a goodbye to concern for people in the cities. They were left with leftover space, and people doesn't work and live and thrive in leftover space. Also, modernism was a goodbye to knowledge about human scale, because now we could make everything so big. And with this plan, method of planning, we always made it a little bit bigger just to be safe. So we built bigger spaces and higher buildings, whatever. And in this process where we left the ground and moved up here, we lost the knowledge about human scale, which is a completely different scale from this airplane scale. And still to this day, there is a fantastic insecurity among architects and planners about what is a good scale for people. We become completely confused. The other big paradigm which has been very influential in the last 50 years, of course, has been the car invasion, started in really big numbers around 1960. And it became very dominating in planning. It became so much dominating that in many cities, the major purpose of city planning is to make the cars happy. And then it went from bad to worse, and now we have phase three, where the car is king in many, many communities around the world. This is, as you can see, it's a typical pedestrian crossing in Moscow, a cross between a pedestrian crossing and parking space and a slalom training course. Car is king. Also with the cars, we got further confused about scale, because in the old days we had 5 kilometers an hour scale. It was made for our senses, it was made for our movement. Things could be small, signs could be small, but now we have the 60-kilometer challenge. If you move 60 kilometers, everything has to be big. The roads have to be big, the signs big, everything. You cannot see any details, so why make details? All this was a result of the car invasion. So further confusion about human scale was caused by this. This is actually the architecture of the suburbs all over the place. So, here. Because the modernists have thrown out all the knowledge we had, handed from generation for generation for making good cities based on spaces for people, we knew nothing in 1960. I know everything about what we did not know because I was trained in exactly that period, and there was no knowledge that it mattered if you put the buildings this way or the other way. Man will find out, and if he had hot water in the bathroom, he would be happy and whatever. So it was believed that it was no problem however you built stuff. There was no influence from the physical to the social world. Nothing was known. Then, of course, came the first strong voice that something was wrong. That came from America, came from New York, came from Jane Jacobs, who had been fighting Robert Moses in New York to prevent. He wanted to take down Manhattan so he could build a brave new Manhattan with freeways and high-rise all over. One of the first things to go would be Greenwich Village, which was redundant and old-fashioned and was from the previous guy, not from modern man, so it has to go. Unfortunately, Jane Jacobs lived there, and she was architectural critic, and she became the torchbearer in a movement against this city plan. They fought vigorously, they won, and the plan was shelved. And she wrote this book, which is now, of course, the Bible of humanistic city planning, and she's the grandmother, the godmother of humanistic city planning. And what she said in this for the first time was that if the modernists and the motorists are to plan this world, then it will not be great cities, it will be dead cities. And she further warned all architects and planners, look out of the window and see how people use your cities, how life goes on. Don't sit in your studios and think about what it could be and all the technical gimmicks you could think about. That was Jane Jacobs. She was the first, and she has had a tremendous influence. It took some while, but all of us know about her and can refer to her. And gradually, she's got status just like this other guy. I saw this poster in Toronto last year, and Jesus was looking after the end of time while Jane Jacobs would be looking after the future of cities, which of course was very important. So she's still very much alive, Jane Jacobs. I would say that my work has been very much in the spirit of Jane Jacobs' thinking and writing, and she became a good friend. And I have some very nice letters from her framed in our office. One is about a broken leg, handwritten, 2 pages. The story of my own life is that I graduated as an architect in 1960. I was trained in the 50s. And what did we do in the architecture school in the 50s? We spent about 5 years doing so. Bingo. And then 2 times a day we bent towards Basilia. That was a big thing in planning. That was made from maybe 10 kilometers up. It looks fantastic from the air. It's a bird, it's an eagle. The head of the eagle is the parliament, and the big monuments of Nehemiah is very beautiful. And down at eye level, Brasilia is shit. But they never thought there would be any people there, I guess. This is Lindström, Professor Lindström, and he was famous for saying that a good housing area is something which looks smashing from the freeway. And this is Täby, which looks very smashing from the freeway, but I don't know if it looks very smashing from any other angles. But he was hanging over the model and doing it the way we have trained. I went out of School of Architecture at that point to do all these wonderful things, modern world, modern man, wonderful. So I was going to do all these fantastic things to make life for people better. And then I married a psychologist. And at once we had another atmosphere in the house. We had a lot of young architects, a lot of young psychologists and sociologists. We had a very lively dialogue, and always we had a bad time architects. They kept saying, why are you architects not interested in people? Why don't they teach you anything about people in School of Architecture? Have you ever thought while your professors go out 5 o'clock in the morning to take photos of the monuments so there are no distracting people in the foreground? Have you thought about that? Thinking about my own architectural education, I can think of many, many lectures where you can sit for an hour and a half and look at a lecture in architecture where there's not a single person in any of the pictures. That was not so easy for a young man at that time. And my wife and I, we realized that so little was known. We had this strong inkling that it meant quite a bit how you organized your elements and what was in the elements and how was the spaces between. Nothing was known. So I was forced to go back to School of Architecture for 40 more years to learn what they didn't tell me in the first time I was there. And then I found out that they didn't know a shit about this subject. So we had to invent this subject. And what I worked on for all these years and ever through my career has been to make people visible in architecture and city planning. And I'll just show you a few little examples. Here we are. What is this? This is School of Architecture in Copenhagen. They moved to a new location out in the harbor. They got a very famous landscape architect to make the landscaping. He made some lawns of grass with metal edges, as you know you shall do nowadays. So he made this. And what is this in the foreground? That is a corner. And what is this in the background? That is a canteen. So what happens is that the students come around the corner and see the coffee. And what do students do when they see the coffee? They go for the coffee. And so the landscape architect thought that they would go like this and turn right angle here and turn right angle there and turn, and then they get the coffee here. That's not human beings. So the students do exactly what could be expected of them, and actually the landscape architect could have foreseen this if he had thought just a little bit. So 2 weeks later, he had to come out and do a little modification to his fine project. Homo sapiens, people is very, very conscious with energy, their own energy. If they can see where they are to go, they go for it. And if that, not enough about that. And these are just little examples. Another thing we looked much into that was we found what was called the edge effect. That is, that people who are to stay in a place for a while, they tend to go out to the edge. And again, if you sort of stand in the middle for 20 minutes, everybody would start to say, what's he doing there? What's he doing there? Maybe we better call the police. It looks suspicious. So you are here and you're floating in midair, we call it. But what you will do is, of course, you will drift over and stand at the edge where your back is covered, where you are not in the way and you are not sort of doing something unusual. Everybody will accept you standing at the edge. And here you have the whole area in front of you. Your senses are all out here, and you can command a whole place. Nobody can sneak up from behind and say, hello. you are completely safe and comfortable here. So we have the edge effect all over the world. This is St. Peter's Square in Rome. This is a place in Barcelona. Then we started to speculate. Maybe architects are different from other people. And then we actually started to do an international survey of behavior of architects. And I went personally around to architecture schools and make thorough studies in how architecture students behaved. And here it is, Chalmers up there in the corner, and Copenhagen, Edinburgh, and Aberdeen. We found, when we are compressing all the results, we found that architects were exactly like other people. And then we started to speculate who will put up these benches. And I can give you a written guarantee that nobody would sit on these places unless they're very, very, very desperately tired. But maybe it looks good on the plan, I don't know. And if, give you an advice, if you do things like this, come with some bronze people and put them there, or nobody else will use your benches. So there are some simple rules here. Another thing I've heard very often is that people are very different from one region to the next. And I've studied these things in Australia and Africa, in South America, North America, and Japan, whatever, in Asia. And I found that Homo sapiens is very much the same species. We have the same biological history. We are same height. We have the same senses. There's so much which are the same, including much of our behavior. And then last year I was in Moscow and found that the people were sitting like this on one of the squares and said, oh, have we seen this before? Yes, we saw that the other year in America, because man is a distance animal, that we always keep people at a distance. You are not allowed to touch anybody unless you are invited to. And if I look out here, I can see nobody touching no one, because we are not supposed to do that unless we are invited. And if we do it anyway, we say, excuse me, or something like that. So all of them, there's so much behavior which is the same in the Arab world, in Africa, in Japan, everywhere, whatever. There are many more things which are common for Homo sapiens than which are different from area to area. Then I started to put some of these, all of these things in systematic notes and started to publish it. The first one, as we heard, was Life Between Buildings from 1971. That's 47 years ago. And then, to my great surprise, it took 16 years, but then it started. The book started, my little thesis book started to be published in all kind of funny languages. And I'm especially proud that many developing countries have picked up these ideas and thought they could be useful for humanizing the planning in their growing cities. Then, much later, came another book called Cities for People. And the story behind that is that just as you have Mistra here in Sweden, we have in Denmark a stinking rich foundation called Realdania. And already they started their work in year 2000. And from the day one, they came down to School of Architecture to me and said, Jan, we think you're doing something valuable. Do you have enough money? You should never say that to a university person. First, I say, yeah, it's all right, and we are doing fine. But wouldn't you like some more PhD students? Yeah, and guest professors and study tours and whatever. Yeah, yeah. How many millions do you think you need? And then they were playing this game with the millions, and suddenly I had 15 millions. And then we had a research center, whatever. That was fine. Then I left university because I was too old. Now they have another rule. You don't have to you can be too old and still stay, but not that time, because that's many years ago. I was 70. And then they came a number of years later, say, Jan, we would like you to write a book about everything you know after 40 years of study, and write it as you can still remember it. And then they said, we know you have no time, but if we say you can have one for this and one for that and one for the pictures and one for the layout and the translation and an extra one to him to get the coffee. And suddenly I had time, and then we made this one, which is the same subject as Life Between Buildings. And some people ask me, what is the difference between this one and Life Between Buildings? It's 40 years. So in between, we learned a lot more, and now we start to have examples about how this knowledge can be used. And in no time to speak of, it has sort of been distributed worldwide. And it's available in all major languages except Swedish. Indian, Arabic, Farsi, the Greeks. Yeah, the Greeks phoned me and said, we would like to publish your book. And I said, are you phoning from Greece? Yeah. No, you should not use your money in Greece for my little book. You have many more important things to use your money for. And then they said, no, don't worry. The Danish embassy looks after that. Fine, you can have the book right away. The last one makes me especially proud. That's the French. It took 43 years since I started to publish before the first book arrived in French. And did it come out in Paris? No. It came out in Montreal. But from there, they are exporting it to France. I'm very proud of that. This book is now out in 30 some languages, and before the year, next year's over, it will be, I guess, 40 languages around the world. And this, what does this show? It doesn't show, in my opinion, that this book is fabulous and whatever. It shows that there has been so little research done. There are so little literature available. And there's such a great need worldwide for having a more humanistic approach to city planning that people have digested this book from one end of the world to the other. So, in conclusion of all that, now, I said 1960, we knew almost nothing. At this point now, 48 years later, I would say we know quite a bit. We know enough to make wonderful people-oriented city planning, sustainable cities, great cities for people. We know enough, and one can then start to wonder, is this knowledge used? While all this research was being done here and there, of course, the world has changed, the situation has changed, and we have new challenges in the 21st century. And actually, by now, definitely, after year 2000, it's distinctly possible to see that we have a new planning paradigm. Because if you ask the mayor in any city, would you like a livable, sustainable, and healthy city? They will say, that's my program. That's exactly what we are wanting to do in this city. Not that they do it, but they want. So this livable, sustainable, and healthy is very evident in many of the city policies. People are sick and tired of all this technocratic city planning, of all this bending down to the cars and making the city ideal for the cars, but not for people. They have been chased enough. And also they know more now and they have more time to think about what the planners have given to them. So all this about the lively and livable city, we know, or we can start now say, man is a social animal. The greatest interest of man is other people. Throughout the history, we've had spaces where we could meet other people, see the people we are in society with, meet our neighbors face to face, see the girls, see whatever is happening, and learn from society with our own eyes. This is one of the most important things in throughout the history of development of man, that we gather together to meet and develop our culture. And we need the public spaces has an important role in this process, and we love what there is offered. If we were all given a telephone and sent down to Sahara and told to spend our lives with the telephone out in the sand, we will be crazy inside a few days, because we need the stimulation of real people and of meeting them with our own senses. Every time now, when we make good public spaces, they will be used immediately. We also have heard that if you have all these, then cyberspace will take over after public space. No such thing. In this period, when all this digital stuff has been developed, we've seen the public space being more and more developed and used more and more, because in the same time, we've got more and more leisure time. And at least in our part of the world, we have smaller and smaller households. In Copenhagen, every other household is one person. And to have any life or knowledge of other people, you have to go out of your flat. So we've seen an increasing use of public space. Of course, people now combine checking the phone and being in public space, but we have time to both. The other thing is that we want a sustainable city. I'll not talk much about this here, because you are experts. But the more people walk, the more they bike, the better for the climate. And also when we are, which we will have to, when we are to have other modes of mobility than the private car, then various forms of public transportation will have an increasing importance in the next period of time. And then we have to have a good public transportation system, you need a good public realm, so in style and comfort and safety, you can go to the stations and the stops, whatever, to and from. A new challenge we've experienced is the sitting syndrome. And when we close our eyes and think what we've been doing for the last 50 years, we made everything in city planning to make people not walk. We have made everything to make people sitting. And we have had severe consequences now. My daughter is a senior doctor, and she has worked. She told me a lot about this. And that if you can have 1 hour of moderate exercise a day, you can live 7 years longer, and your old days will be a much better quality, and it will be extremely more cheap for society, because there's a lot of sickness you won't attract if you keep yourself active throughout the life. Not every Sunday, but every day a little bit. It's also been found out now that people in suburbs live shorter than people in cities, because in the cities there are more stairs and they walk more. In the suburbs, they sit more. And when all this is told, they have a very distinctive, different length of life. So stay in the city if you can. World Health Organization, in their global action plan for all the countries in the world, they recommend that we promote safe traveling to and from schools, such as walking and cycling. Keep moving, my friends. That's the new mantra. Also, another thing which has come up now and is increasingly being discussed among the planners is that we are having already 20% elderly people in some of our societies going towards 25%. In Japan, it's closing 30 or 33% of the population are elderly. They are generally in good shape and they should have a good life, but what should the city be like to make sure that these people are having a good quality of life and that they can do as much they can without being too sick and too much expensive for the health system, but basically have a good quality of life? That is a very important question, which is now. And then comes sort of my conclusion that if you want a lively city, livable city, sustainable city, healthy city, good city to be old in, then it's a very, very smart policy to look after people in city planning, because that will address these issues, all of them. Da-da. That means water. Then we can ask, are there cities today which have a policy saying, we will do everything we can to invite people to walk and bicycle as much as possible in the course of their daily doings? Yeah, there are more and more cities doing this now. And I'll take you on a quick walk to some of the cities I have been involved in, just as examples. There's Melbourne. They started in 1985 with such a people-oriented policy. By that time, it was an impossible city center. It was completely empty in the weekends and in the evenings. It was only offices, and there was no people at all. This has completely changed. And they had at that time 600 apartments in the city center. Now they have 40,000 apartments. They've done everything to have people move in to the city center by various means, among them to build a lot of high stuff in the fringes. But enough about that. They have the policy that in this city we walk, so they widened all the sidewalks, they put granite on all the sidewalks, they put trees on all the sidewalks, so you can walk in shade. And they say, in Melbourne, we have cities and we walk. And they have made the nicest street furniture program in the world. They've done everything to make it a wonderful city for people to move about in. I was there just recently, and you could hardly now get through the sidewalks because there were so many people all over the place. They have great discussions now. What do we do? We have too many people using our cities instead of having a completely empty city center. I would say that when it comes to street life and ambience, Melbourne now has a distinct touch of Paris, but the climate is much better. So the conclusion is, if you don't know what to do, move to Melbourne. It is by far the best city in the Southern Hemisphere. It's on top of all the lists of Monaco and Economist and whatever livable cities in the world. Melbourne is always number one or two after or before Copenhagen. Anyway, it's on top, in the top five all the time. They have done very well, and it's a very, very nice city by now. Another city which is working hard on this agenda of people-oriented city planning is Sydney. And Sydney is fantastic waterfront, but the city center and the main street, Sydney, really awful, full of buses and cars and narrow street and fumes and noise, whatever. It has been hard work to get the buses and cars out of Sydney, but now we have succeeded, and they are pedestrianizing the center part, and they are putting in light rails instead of this old fashioned way. Another city which have done wonders is New York. The mayor, Michael Bloomberg, in 2006, he formulated a new policy. He promised the world, I will make New York the most sustainable metropole in the world in no time to speak of. That means, while I'm still mayor. And he said, it's a flat city, it's a compressed city, it's got wide streets, it's a perfect city for bicycling. I have a very good subway, I have good streets for bicycling, and I have wide sidewalks. We don't need any commuting with cars in Manhattan, in New York. He said, forced to do that. He sent his people to Copenhagen right away, where I remember it was very, very interesting to have them. They were there for 48 hours. They had bicycles, and we couldn't get the bicycles away from them because they kept going around in bicycle. And it was one of those days in June where it was gorgeous weather, and because that was the beginning of the summer, everybody left the house and was sitting outside. And every time we turned a corner with these New Yorkers, there was 1,000 Copenhageners sitting there waving to them and whatever. And it was great. And we couldn't get the bicycles away from them during the night in the hotel. No, they would keep them. And then in the airport, we finally got them. And then they said, we want a city like this one. When can you come? I was quick, so I said, we can come on Monday. And then we were commissioned to assist New York in putting in 10-kilometer bicycle lanes. That's what they've done now. And then we started to work on making public spaces. They had no benches, no sidewalk cafes. You were meant to walk all the time between the subway and the office and back again. And then they started to say, oh, if we could have a Champs-Élysées here, or if we could have some of the wonderful squares you have in Europe. And then we started to say, what about Broadway? Do you really need Broadway for traffic? And the traffic planner said, yes, of course we need Broadway for traffic. But it's one-way traffic next to 7th Avenue, which also same way one-way traffic. Are you sure? Then they had 1 year to figure out a model. Then they came out and said, yeah, no, actually, we don't need Broadway for traffic. Actually, the traffic will be smoother and run better if we don't have Broadway. That was the opening. So now we could close Broadway in all the important places where Broadway crossed the avenues. Most importantly, of course, in Times Square. Times Square was called a square, but it was not a square. It was a fantastic traffic congestion. And people were squeezed. 90% of the people who were in Times Square were on the sidewalks, where they had 10% of the space. 10% of the people were on 90% of the space, which was for cars. Then came the big day in 2009, when Broadway, all these places along Broadway, among Times Square, was closed. And in no time, it started to look like this. The mayor, he'd been out there saying, don't worry, don't worry. The taxi drivers was very worried. But don't worry, it's only an experiment. Half a year later, he said, experiment? No way. It's the greatest thing which has happened in America since Jane Jacob wrote what we should do 50 years ago. It's still there. It's very popular. And you can see the other places. Now they've got 50 squares like this one all over New York, all on asphalt taken from the cars, because the cars all over the world has got too much asphalt. They can do with less asphalt. This same model of making better cities and sort of trying to harness the cars, you can find it anywhere. Up in Vilnius, they're up to a good start. Don't park in my bike lanes, say the mayor here. In Bucharest, in Romania, they have a little traffic problem. But now they have got my book in Romanian, and they will sort it out very quickly, undoubtedly. Then I told about all these cities we worked in at a conference in Montreal, and this man came galloping up to me and said, I'm the deputy mayor of Moscow. We would like to humanize Moscow. We have a hurry on. We need to do it in 12 months. When can you come? And then I learned I should just say Monday. And then I said Monday, and then we were there right after. And we were completely shocked when we saw what was happening, had happened in Moscow. It was in 2012. And we started to formulate that freedom from communism is the right to park wherever you like. And they've got a lot of cars and they've got no rules for parking, no parking police, no parking fee. Just take your car and go in and see if you can find a stair or monument to put your park, your car on, or a sidewalk, whatever. Here is a nice residential street. Here is, what is this? This is Main Street, Moscow sidewalk, full of parked cars because there wasn't enough car parking. So they take in the sidewalks and left for all the 14 million Moscovites with 1 meter of sidewalk on the main street. But they were very, very quick in Moscow. They said, Jan, how many books have you written? We'll publish them all. And then in 3 months, they have three of them published, and they have the seal of Moscow in the corner. They're published by City of Moscow, and they were handed out for free to all the students and all the people in the various parts of the city administration. The guy who is a little bit worried over there, he's a Danish ambassador. And we were hired to make a study of Moscow and come up with a plan for humanizing Moscow. And now I'll tell you a very special history because I've never seen anything like this anywhere. This is Main Street Moscow in 2011. Gray Street, car parking all the way. The air is full of advertisements. Just a year and a half later, no advertisements. The gray streets are beginning to be green, and instead of the cars, there are benches. All this is gone now because now the sidewalk has been doubled, the trees have been put properly down, and also they've got much better furniture. That was a very quick start. Also, the street now has become so good that they don't need their coats anymore as compared to here. So it was really a miracle. This is another little street with a little bit of parking in the old days. Now this street looks like this. And this is a corner near Pushkin Monument on the main street of Moscow. Over the years, a few items have blown into this square and sort of settled there and had a good time there. I heard somebody say that there was even a subway station in there somewhere. But that was, it looked like McDonald's. But that's then coming back 4 years later, that are miracle. And you can see the metro station. We told them in Moscow that in all the other major capitals of the world, they have celebrated their riverfronts. In Moscow, all the riverfronts were used for parking and driving. Not so anymore. They are full speed reclaiming their riverfronts so they can walk and bike and have a good time. This is the exit from one of the major metro stations. They used to step right out in 4 or 5 lanes of traffic. Now they step up into a big square for pedestrians. And what do we find on this square? We find 12 enormous swings for some 3-4 people in each swing. And it appeared that these swings were used throughout the day and night. They were always swinging. They were very happy about swinging. I got a good idea. Maybe we need some more swings in this world. But anyway, I was there in Moscow last year, and then they came up to me and said, hey, Jan, do you realize we have a serious baby boom now in Moscow? And do you know that's your fault? Because you are the one who took the cars out of the parks, who put benches into the boulevards, who put up the swings and did all these awful things which make people enjoy the city and have a good time. I'm proud. Moscow has completely changed, and I thought that that was something they did because they wanted a better situation for mankind. then of course I realized that they had the soccer championship last year or this year, and they were just finished before that, and everybody thought it was such a nice capital. But that's good for people and the baby boom. So be it. The first one city almost in the world to really start a policy of people first has actually been Copenhagen. And they started in 1962. And that was bloody early. That was the time when Jane Jacobs was writing in New York. They took the car park, the cars out of Strøget, the 1 kilometer long main street in Copenhagen. There was big discussions because it was said that you'll ruin the city and all the shops will go broke and it will never be used. And we were Danes, we were not Italians, and we were loved our Volkswagens more than any other nation in the world. So you could not do this to the Danes. They did it anyway. And then we found just a year later that they started to be Italians because they had no room to be Italians before that. Here is Copenhagen in 62 with one with Strøget and a little part of one of the squares being pedestrianized. If you go back to the same place today, it will look like this. Every year they've done a little bit more than last year, and this is just the city center. There has been in Copenhagen a very interesting interrelationship between the School of Architecture and the city, because Copenhagen became the first place in the world where the life in the city was systematically studied. And that was studied by researchers from the Royal Academy School of Architecture. And because Denmark is a small little country and we had this center for studying city life, that came to have a great influence on the policy of the city. Again, because we are a small nation, we knew each other, all of us. And after a few years, we start to come to the city planners and they come down to us. Every time they had a problem, they ran over to the School of Architecture and say, what do we do here? So Copenhagen, there was a fantastic collaboration between gown and town. And I think we had one of the centers in the world for studying city life. And I think that that is the same effect. If you had a university which is very good in heart transplant and come back there 20 years later, you will find there are more people in that city who has a heart transplant than in the other city where the university is into something else. That has happened in Copenhagen. And it has happened to such a degree that when Copenhagen turned 850 years last year, they came running. Actually, they pointed out, they made a list of 10 people who have influenced Copenhagen. And by God, if I was not on the list, I was responsible for today's Copenhagen. Was I proud? I spent the whole month of this festival going around to see the posters they put up all over the city. But so universities can change the world if we work hard. If we now we have this evidence, we can just mention that we know a lot about how public life has developed. We know that was the first phase where there was emphasis on walking just to get the cars out of the way so we could have room for walking. Then we got the next phase, we got tired of walking, we wanted to sit down. That was the period where all the squares were cleared, where the cafe culture was unfolding, where tourists were pouring in, and they don't walk all the time, they need to sit. There was also the time when culture started to happen in the squares, public culture, public space culture, and we saw this developing very much in this period, also because the Danes started to travel, and they came back from Greece and Spain and Italy and France, having seen wonderful places, and say, couldn't we have a wonderful place here? Now we are into the fourth phase, where there are more and more in the new squares being made nowadays. more and more emphasis on activity, sports and so forth, swimming in the harbor, for one example, bicycling, skateboarding, whatever. And the most recent one is to combine climate protection and recreation. They have a number of places which have been very swamped when there were torrential rains, and they've now turned these areas into sponges. So everything is done that the rain which comes down is sucked up on the in the neighborhood and not let into the ocean. And then all the squares become lakes or wetlands. And when they are not lakes and wetlands, they are wonderful playgrounds. So they use the money to make a much better area, which can also take the climate changes. Copenhagen also is the first city in the world who has made an official policy. We will be the best city in the world for people. And we will do it because we think the more you use the public spaces, it's good for livability, good for sustainability, good for your health, good for social inclusion, and it's good for democracy. And just to make safe, I brought a copy for the mayor of Gothenburg, who can copy it if you like. Some example, because now it's not a matter of making the city center wonderful for tourists, whatever. It's a matter of making the whole city good for people. And here's just an example. All the major streets in Copenhagen has been transformed from 3-4 lanes, 4-5 lanes to 2 lanes, one either direction, a median, bicycle lanes, street trees. And this lower one is much more beautiful. It's much more safe for all categories. And it can take the same number of cars as the other street because the traffic engineers are much more clever than they were earlier on. And one of the other ideas you can find all over Copenhagen is the continuous sidewalk. That is, on all the major streets, the sidewalks go through, the bicycle lane goes through, and all the side streets going in there, the cars have to go up on the sidewalk and down again. That means that my granddaughter, Laura, 7, now can walk all the way to school because she can stay on the sidewalk from her door to the school's door. And she would not be able to cross 4 streets on the way to school when she's 7. She can now. And that makes a strong and proud 7-year-old. She's a little bit older now, but I remember how it was. So they've done a lot to make it a good city for people. And also, at the same time, they've made a lot to make it a good city for bicycles. They also have another policy saying, we will be the best in the world for bicycles. There's a complete network of good bicycle lanes with curb to the cars and curb to the sidewalk all over the city. It's used as a transportation system. Every 3rd family has a cargo bike, and the kids love to sit in a cargo bike. This morning, I saw a kindergarten going around with cargo bikes, with 4 kids in each cargo bike. They love to sit out there and follow what's going on, much rather than sitting behind in a car. The crucial thing in a bicycle system is the crossings. They have studied this, and they made them pretty safe. And they are now in a state so that when my grandchildren are 12 years, they are allowed to go all over the city on a bicycle. That means they can go to sports and friends, whatever. It's, of course, integrated with the city transportation systems. You can take your bike for free in the city trains, which is very popular. There's a lot of things have been done, but we'll just stop here and say what has happened in Copenhagen is that definitely a very strong bicycle culture has step by step been developed. Everybody bikes, the businessmen, the pregnant mothers, the children, the crown princess, even if she is Australian, and the coming king, he is very good in biking also. And if you can't bike yourself because you are too old, you are being biked. They have a special organization who takes elderly people around in their old neighborhoods so they get wind in the hair and see the old neighborhood from eye level. And of course, with all this infrastructure, we started to have problems. Major problem in Copenhagen now is congestion on the bicycle lanes. And what do? You just widen the bicycle lanes to double width. And where do you get the asphalt from? You get it from the cars, because you can have five times more people on a bike lane than you can in a car lane. So if you have enough bicycles, it's very good transport economy to make wider bike lanes. They're doing all kinds of stuff, no time to tell about it. There are many new bridges being built specifically to make it quicker and smarter to take the bicycle. The principle is every place you have to go, it shall be easier and more practical to take your bicycle. So these many bridges and make shortcuts, and they are very popular. End of this story. But again, like with the pedestrians and public space, an impressive culture of using bicycle has evolved gradually. Now 41% of everybody going to work or study in Copenhagen arrive on bicycles, which makes that there are less traffic than in other cities of this size. And we could go on and talk about influence on mindset, because it's all something about influencing the way people think, so they start to think people, sustainability, livability, whatever. One of my favorite pictures is this one. This is not my grandmother. This is the Minister of Culture in Denmark, and she told me one day, you should look at my website. I looked at her website. There she was, sitting in a sofa with my book. And she said that was a photo session of cultural ministers from around Europe. They should sit in their favorite sofa with their favorite book. And Jan, I took the English version so people can see what I'm interested in. But more importantly, she is the one who has made a Danish architectural policy put people first. So we could end here. Welcome to the 21st century. And also we could even say that even in the neighboring neighborhoods, they have shown interest in our city planning. So hooray, hooray, many good things can be said. But now I'll just end by showing some of the things which I think we are not good at any place in the world. Some places a little bit better than other places. These books and this knowledge and this research by Jane Jacobs and myself and many other people, that is now frequently used to make existing cities much better for people. We have endless many examples, I've shown you some. But when we go to the new developments built at the same time, Ørestad and other new settlements here and there, you wonder, haven't they learned a bit in all these years? It's still very much modernism. And certainly Jane Jacobs, her voice is not heard very widely. The planners are still hanging over their models and sort of doing it this way. In Dubai, a special group of persons who have developed in this period, which are the bird shit architects, they are still flying all over and dropping there. And they are still having this idea that if you have enough buildings, you have a city, you do not have a city. You may have a perfume bottle collection. Form must follow fashion, but you do not have a city just by dropping many bird shit pieces. Certainly, Jane Jacobs and the kind of humanistic studies I've been involved in, and this kind of stuff is not used in many, many of these places. And there's nothing more unsustainable and actually awful, more awful than, I think, places like Dubai. Form must follow fashion. And also new towns. This is Ørestad in Copenhagen, which makes me shameful because it's done in Copenhagen right under my eyes. They didn't ask me. They just did it. And when people say, how could you do this in Denmark? I say, it's done by some people from Finland who came straight out of the woods in Finland and didn't know about cities. They did Ørsted. I think it's awful. This is rush hour in Ørsted, where they have far too much space for far too few people. The other day, I saw this sign in Ørsted, our greatest task is to make perfect places to jump into your bed. Oh, my dear, is this really the dream for a city of the future, where you can jump into your bed? Not impressed. Cities for the future, we're almost there. There are dreams and there are worries. If people ask me, what shall we do? I'll tell you, don't do Dubai. It's modernism and motorism in extreme forms, and this guy has been standing there now for years. He cannot get across the street at all. What I will end by saying, we are starting to say, do we actually have some models which could be the framework for something we could do in the future? I will end by saying, what to do? Why not try humanistic city planning? Why not try putting people first? Why not try a model inspired a bit by Copenhagen, but doing it much better? So putting people first in city planning, that's the simplest and cheapest thing you can do. It creates better cities for everyone from 0 year to 100 year. And it is city which is for all parts of the world because it is so cheap. It's mostly to think in this new way, not to invest in new gimmicks. So, my friend, good luck with your future cities and Merry Christmas.